Alright, so we'll continue where we left off yesterday. We were talking about number representations and essentially trying to see what are some ways by which we can represent fractional or real values in binary. Okay, so the idea is very simple. We know how to represent integers. So this would, for example, in binary correspond to the number 106 in decimal, right? So this notation, basically putting parentheses and then indicating the radix as a subscript, is sometimes used. It's not very common, but it's a simple way of indicating which radix we are using, okay? And I'll be using that if I want to distinguish between which base or radix I am using at a given point in time. So this would be an integer. A real value would essentially involve introducing a decimal point or a binary point somewhere in this number, right? So I'm going to use the term decimal point, binary point, or just point interchangeably, right? It should be clear from the context that all I mean is basically, you know, the position of the dot that separates the integer part from the fractional part, right? So for example, if I wrote it like this, this would essentially correspond to 6.625 in decimal, which is basically equal to 106 divided by 2^4. Okay, so the same value, essentially the correspondence between these two is directly because of this connection, you know, the division factor over here. Now in terms of terminology, what we say is this is sometimes called the integer part and this is the fractional part. Okay, so we would like to use both of them, the integer part as well as the fractional part, in order to represent numbers. Now there are a few things that come up as a result of this particular choice that we have made, right? One of them in particular is, what is the range of numbers that I can represent by doing so? Okay, so in order to understand the range of representable values, let's just first consider an 8-bit integer. Okay, what I'm going to assume is 2's complement representation. And remember that when I say 2's complement format or 2's complement representation, it doesn't automatically mean that you take a number and immediately, you know, complement it and add 1 and so on, right? All that I'm saying is, if I want to represent a negative number, I will use the so-called 2's complement representation of that number. If it's a positive number, the number basically remains exactly as it would have been in normal circumstances. The distinguishing factor, the easy way to distinguish whether a number is positive or negative, would be positive numbers will start with a 0 and negative numbers will start with a 1. That's just the property of how the 2's complement is defined and, you know, how it's taken, right? So the 2's complement format is just saying, again, like I told you, right, this is all convention, right? At the end of the day, all that is stored inside the memory of a computer is 8 bits, okay, 8 binary values, zeros or ones, okay? Do you choose to represent them as an integer, a real valued number, a character, or just a meaningless byte, is entirely up to you and the application that is reading it. For those of you who are familiar with some C programming, you will find that this is put to both good and bad use in C, right? The good use is basically that it makes it very easy to basically easily interpret a stream of bytes as something completely different from what it was supposed to be. The bad news is it allows you to interpret a stream of bytes as something completely different from what it was supposed to be. Okay, so it's a two-edged sword. Unless you know what you are doing over here, you can end up doing something wrong. So what happens in integer 8-bit values with 2's complement? essentially what we are saying is the decimal value 0 would be represented by a value of all zeros. Decimal 1 would be 1 and so on, which means that the maximum positive value that I can think about would essentially correspond to this number, because the moment I add 1 to this, I'm going to get a 1 on my most significant bit, and according to my convention that represents negative numbers, okay? And if I take that into account, then basically what this says is that 127 or 2 power 7 minus 1 is the maximum positive number that can be represented in this way, okay? What about negative values? Right, this number, in order to find out what the actual value is supposed to be, I need to take the 2's complement, because I know that it's a leading one, it's supposed to represent a negative number. Therefore, if I take the 2's complement, what happens? It converts to 0 followed by all 1's. I add 1 to it, I basically get back the same number. So in other words, the magnitude is going to be 128 and the sign is negative. So this is essentially minus 128, which is basically minus 2 power 7. Okay, and you will find that this becomes minus 127, etc., up to minus 1, okay, which would basically be all ones. So this is the entire range of values that can be represented using integer 2's complement, right? If you look at it, it actually has a interesting pattern to it. Essentially what is going to happen is, if I just put the index over here or the code, right, I'll find that I basically keep on rising up to this point, right, which basically corresponds to plus 127. I abruptly have a transition all the way to minus 128 and then go back to 0. Okay, so this, what we, this transition that we see over here is sometimes called wraparound, right? Essentially what it's saying is, when I go above 127, I abruptly switch over to a large negative, the largest negative value, and then start ascending again from there. Okay, in some particular cases this might actually even be useful, because when I'm doing pure wraparound arithmetic, it turns out that if I temporarily wrap around but then once again I subtract some values, I can get back into my normal range without actually losing any data. The other alternative is, let's say that if I'm trying to go above 127, I would do a saturation. I would say numbers can't go above 127. If you try adding 1 to 127, it will remain 127. Okay, so there are pros and cons for both methods. We will in fact look at some of those as we go later. Both can be implemented, both have, they have corresponding problems in terms of implementation in hardware and so on. Alright, so now what happens if I am talking real valued numbers? And what I'm going to say is, I'm going to use a 4.4 representation. Okay, now 4.4 is how I'm going to pronounce this, not 4.4, right? Essentially to sort of make it clear that I'm sort of trying to convey what is the representation I'm using for this. So a 4.4 format in this way essentially means that 4 bits of integer, 4 bits of fraction, therefore total of 8 bits. Okay, this is not a completely standardized representation. This is sometimes called the m.n notation, right? You will sometimes also see this called a q4.4 representation. This is called the q notation, right? There is another one, the Xilinx notation essentially refers to a class of, that is defined inside Xilinx, called AP fixed, arbitrary precision fixed point numbers, where you would write this as 8 comma 4 right, and 8 comma 4 essentially means 8 is the total number of bits of which 4 are integer. Okay, so all of these are different notations for essentially the same thing. You are saying that you have a total of 8 bits, 4 of them are going to be used for integer, the remaining 4 are going to be used to represent the fraction. Okay, with this what happens? The same number as before, but now by explicitly putting in a decimal point over there, this corresponds to the value 0. What does this correspond to? The smallest increment, that is basically 2 power minus 4. Okay, 2 power minus 4 I think is some 0.08 or something of that sort, right? It doesn't matter, the actual value is 2 power minus 4. Okay, therefore we can just, you know, go forward from there. This would correspond to 2 into 2 power minus 4, etc. Okay, and I finally get to 011.1111, which is going to be the integer part over here is 7.9 something. Okay, in other words, this is actually equal to 8 minus 2 power minus 4. Okay, so that's a simple way of looking at it, right? If we contrast this with what we had previously, we had 127 corresponding to this 011.1111. Now I'm looking at this, I'm taking the exact same value, 127, and dividing by 16. That is the 7.9 something that I'm going to see over here. Okay, which as it is, as it happens, is the largest positive value that I can represent using this notation. Okay, what happens after that? The same as before. This translates into minus 128 divided by 2 power 4. Minus 128 divided by 2 power 4. This is exactly equal to minus 8.000. Okay, until, you know, similarly all the negative numbers also happen. So in other words, all that has happened is just by arbitrarily introducing one decimal point after 4 bits, I have scaled everything by a factor of 2 power 4, right? The range of numbers that I have is now going from 2 power minus 4 as the smallest value to 7.9 something as the largest value. Okay, so an interesting question comes up in this regard, which is something called the dynamic range. Okay, and dynamic range, essentially what it's asking is, what is the range of values that can be represented using a given notation? And by range of values, we want to make it clear that I don't care about positive versus negative. I'm talking about, let's restrict ourselves to the positive part of this notation, right? What is the smallest positive, not non-zero, number that I can represent? And what is the largest positive value that I can represent? Okay? So let's look at integers. Smallest positive number is 8-bit integers, okay? What is the smallest positive number? 1. Okay? Largest positive? 127. Okay? So the dynamic range is basically defined as (127) divided by 1, it's equal to 2 power 7 minus 1. Okay, if I look at the negative values, it would basically be exactly 2 power 7, that is the range, right? This is, the difference is small enough that I'm not going to bother about it. I'm just going to say 2 power 7 in fact as the dynamic range. Okay, now what happens to 8-bit 4.4 numbers? what is the smallest value that I can have? 2 power minus 4. Okay. Largest was that 7.9 something, which if you remember was actually equal to 2 power 3 minus 2 power minus 4. Right? It is basically 8 minus 2 power minus 4. No, I have 4 bits for the this one, right? I'm talking about this notation over here. This value. So it will be 8 bits. So there will be 4 bits before the decimal point. Maximum value can go up to 7. So 2 power 3. Right? So 2 power 3 minus 2 power minus 4. Once again, dynamic range. Is 2 power 3 minus 2 power minus 4 divided by 2 power minus 4, which is exactly equal to 2 power 7 minus 1. Right? So this is sort of just once again stating what should have been obvious to you from the beginning. The dynamic range that we get for 8-bit 4.4 numbers does not really depend on where the decimal point is placed, whether it's 4.4 or you know, the 8-bit integer could be considered as a special case, an 8.0 format, right? 8 bits of integer, 0 bits of fraction, right? So an 8.0 format, 4.4 format, 2.6, 1.7, all of them represent a different range of numbers. The actual maximum will be different, but the ratio of the maximum positive to the minimum positive will always remain the same, okay? And that's just determined by the number of bits that I'm using. Okay. So effectively what we are saying is when I use 8 bit values, in other words, I get a range of 2 power 7, a dynamic range of 2 power 7. Okay. So if I wanted to extend this and I asked you the question, 32 bit, this is essentially what I refer to as fixed point numbers. Okay. I'm just going to ask you 32-bit fixed point numbers. What's the dynamic range that I can get using this kind of notation? 2 power 31. Okay. I'm ignoring the minus 1 because you know it's very small compared to the 2 power 31. The important point is that the 2 power 31 is the actual ratio of the largest positive to the smallest positive number. Now, what is 2 power 31 in terms of 10 power? I know that 2 power 3, which is equal to 8, is approximately equal to 10. A better way of looking at it is 2 power 10 is 1024, which is roughly 10 power 3. 2 power 20 is 1048 something, roughly 10 power 6. Okay. So 2 power 30 is 10 power 9. So this is approximately equal to some 2 into 10 power. Why 10 power? Simply because it makes it easier for us to understand dynamic ranges a bit better. Okay. So using 32 bit values, I'm able to get a dynamic range of 2 into 10 power 9. Now let's try and understand whether that's good or bad, right? What it basically means is if I am just trying to write, let's say, the current in different parts of a circuit, okay, and I want to have some system that can basically represent everything from what is happening inside an IC to what is being generated and transmitted in, you know, a large hydroelectric generator, right? What's the range of numbers that I'm talking about? Inside an IC, my currents could be in the range of microamps for sure, possibly nanoamps. Okay? What's the likely currents that I'm going to get out of a large generator? Right? Even if I'm assuming, you know, kilovolts, I'm still talking about probably at least kiloamps, possibly even more than that. Okay, I already have a dynamic range of 10 power 12. Right, from nanoamps to kiloamps, that's a dynamic range of 10 power 12. Okay, similarly, the capacitances that are present inside ICs, we are talking about femtofarad capacitances inside ICs, all the way up to the supercapacitors that are used for you know, as battery charge supplements for cars and so on, those are probably farads, 10 power 12, 10 power 15 ranges. So in other words, there are definitely a lot of values that we can consider where this kind of dynamic range, 10 power 9, is not going to be sufficient. Okay, how do I increase it? One way is just increase the number of bits. That's the obvious way. Okay, but how much? I go to 2 power 64, my dynamic range will go up to 10 power 18, 19, something like that. Okay, which is probably good enough for most purposes, unless you get into Planck's constant or something of that sort, in which case you can't deal with that also. Okay, so what do we do, right? Before getting to that, let's just briefly look at how would arithmetic with these kind of numbers look, or rather, what does the hardware for arithmetic with these kind of numbers look like? Okay, so in terms of hardware, I'm going to assume that all of you already know what a full adder is. Okay, the basic idea of a full adder is I give it two inputs, A and B, and another input, the carry in. Okay, and it generates two outputs. One is called the sum and the other is the carry out. Okay, the truth table for this, etc., is known. Essentially all that you are doing is, if I add 0 and 0, the output is, sum is 0, carry is 0, 0 plus, or rather, you know, the A and B and also the C in. So there are three inputs, right? There are two values I'm adding, A and B. There's also a carry input. Depending on all the three values, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, etc., I can precisely say what my sum output should be, what my carry output should be, right? And how do I create, let's say, a 4-bit adder out of this? I can cascade these blocks. Right, so it would look something like this. I would have one full adder, A0, B0, and a 0 as the carry input. Okay, I'll get S0 as the output over here. Some carry going out, which I'm just going to directly feed into the my next stage. One, right, so that I can then take this set of values that I have out here and call it my final output, right? I am taking these as my inputs. When I add the A values and the B values together with the overall net carry input of 0, I will get the output S3, S2, S1, S0 as the sum 4-bit value. And potentially there could also be a carry out, if there is essentially sort of saying that, you know, the range of 4 bits was not enough to add these numbers together. Okay. Now the good thing about this is we know how to build full adder circuits. We know how to build them efficiently. You can just chain a lot of these together. So if I wanted to get to a 32-bit full adder, I can do that essentially by extending this. 64-bit full adder can also be done, right? And in fact, a lot of effort has gone into better methods of building adders, so that right now if I look at a 4-bit adder, I can see that, you know, the propagation delay is essentially going to be one long chain through this, because in the worst case a carry is generated at the first stage, that in turn triggers a carry at the second stage, that triggers a carry at the third stage, etc. I have to sort of hop all the way till the end. Okay, that's my worst case in terms of propagation delay. For 32 bits, that could be even worse, right? I mean, that will be even worse. 64 bits, it might get to the point where, you know, that is starting to become the real problem as far as your computations are concerned. Two ways of handling it. One is you improve your technology to the point where full adders are more efficiently done and, you know, have very small propagation delays. The other way is there are other kinds of adder structures, carry look ahead, the logarithmic adders, all of those, a whole bunch of different architectures exist that allow you to do fast addition. Okay, so adding integers is a very well known, well studied problem. Okay, and if I used fixed point, I just get all of that for free, because fixed point numbers are essentially integers with one decimal point somewhere in the middle, which you don't even need to worry about until you are trying to interpret them as numbers. For all your internal computations, you just use them as, you know, integers and move on. Okay. Similarly, you can also handle multiplication. Multiplication is a bit more tricky, because what happens in multiplication is you are now basically getting values that have been scaled by something, right? Or rather, when you multiply to integers, when you multiply to n bit integers, your result can have up to 2n bits. Okay. So if I multiply these, I write out all my partial products, I could essentially end up with something like, you know, what I'll end up with is a 8 bit value. Right? I might need less bits. So in this case, 6 into 2 is 12. So I can manage with 5 bits. But I could do 6 into 6, in which case I probably need 6 or 7 bits. Right? I definitely can't do with 4 bits anymore. Right? So, what do I do in such a situation? I know that I need more bits, and integer multiplication can handle that, right? I know how to build the architecture for that. How do I handle it in fixed point, right? One way of looking at it is a fixed point number f is basically equal to an integer value multiplied by some scaling factor, right? What this means is, if I want to do f1 into f2, this will be equal to i1 times s1 into i2 times s2, which is basically going to be equal to i1 multiplied by i2 into s1 multiplied by s2, or s1 plus S1 multiplied by S2, right? Now, the scaling factors S, this is usually some 2 power something, 2 power minus 4 in our previous example. Okay, so effectively what this is going to say is, this I1 into I2 requires some, some representation, but the position of the decimal, or the point that I put into the number, has to take both of the scale factors into account. Okay? What I'm saying, in other words, is, let's say I take a 4.4 number into another 4.4 number, right? What I will get is a total 8 plus 8, 16 bit number, which is essentially the 4.4 scaling factor is S equal to 2 power minus 4. Here again, S is equal to 2 power minus 4. Here, the S will be equal to 2 power minus 4 into 2 power minus 4 is equal to 2 power minus 8. Okay? So, this basically becomes a 8.8 number. This minus 8 is what determines this. Okay, so effectively one way of thinking about it is, I'm multiplying two numbers that have some number of fractional values, fractional digits. When I multiply them, I get more fractional digits, more precision in the lower order. Okay, it's not that the overall value of what I'm getting is increasing, I'm just getting more digits in the fractional. They also have lower sort of total value, in some sense, right? They are representing smaller and smaller numbers, but those digits are present. What I choose to do with them is a different matter. I might decide to get rid of them at some point. Okay, so if I ever want to take a 4.4 number, another 4.4 number, multiply them and then convert back to a 4.4 number, I need to know where to start dropping bits. If I just sort of drop the most significant bits or the least significant bits, I'm changing the scale factor. Okay, so I need to know what my scale factor is for my result, what scale factor I want, and then choose the appropriate set of bits. Okay, once you start thinking in terms of these scale factors, it is actually relatively simple to keep track of fixed point. You could even think of, for example, a 2.6 number multiplied by a 5.3 number, right? This is 8 bits, this is also 8 bits, result is some 16 bit value. What format will it be? It will have 7 bits for the integer and 9 bits for the fraction, right? Why? Because you can think of this 2.6 number as something into 2 power minus 6, some integer into 2 power minus 6. The 5.3 is some integer into 2 power minus 3. Therefore, integer into integer times 2 power minus 9. Therefore, 7.9. Okay. So, how you keep track of the scaling factors can be determined simply by, you know, as long as your scaling factors are all some 2 power something or other, it's relatively easy to deal with. Okay. So, multiplications can also be handled, right? One thing, going back to the problem of addition, there is one problem which is called alignment, right? Let's say I have a 4.4 number and I have another 2.6 number. How do I add these two values together? Okay, if I just sort of put 8 bit, okay, both are 8 bit numbers, I start adding them together, obviously the answer is wrong. What I need to do is align the points. Okay, so I will need to rewrite this as, and then add. Okay, I will get basically 4 over here and I could get 6 over here, right? If I wanted to convert this back to 4.4, then I can drop this and just get these 4, right? But this alignment is something that you have to keep in mind whenever you are adding fixed point numbers that have different base representations, that have different positions for their decimal point. Okay, alright, so in other words, fixed point is something that can be handled. The good part about it is it essentially, you know, in terms of hardware, it just uses what we can do with integers, right? Good news, because people have studied integers and hardware for integers for a long time, right? The bad news is the dynamic range, essentially, that's what it boils down to, right? The dynamic range is pretty poor. With 32 bits, if I get only 10 power 9, right, it may not be good enough for a lot, especially for scientific computations. Okay, which then gives us a clue about how we can solve the problem also, because we have something called scientific notation, right? After all, nobody writes Planck's constant as 0.0000000. We write it as something 10 power minus, right? Similarly, you know, Avogadro's number 10 power 23, right? Nobody is talking about writing that many zeros after the number. Okay, so scientific notation essentially says I can write something as 3.14 into 10 power 0, or I can write 1.024 into 10 power 3, or I can write 2.5 into 10 power minus 15, right? All of these, the interesting thing is, okay, let me just, yeah. This part over here, is using the same number of digits. Right? And this essentially is my exponent, which is another word for the scaling factor that I had for fixed point numbers. What's the main difference? In fixed point numbers, I gave you a notation. I told you that I'm using 4.4. And the moment I say 4.4, it means all numbers with 4.4 have a scaling factor of 2 power minus 4. But in scientific notation, every number carries its scale factor along with it. So 3.14 into 10 power 0, that number is carrying a scale factor of 0 along with it. 1.02 into 10 power 3 is carrying a scale factor of 10 power 3. 2.50 into 10 power minus 15 is carrying a scale factor of 10 power minus 15. Okay, so each number basically carries its own scale factor along with it. Okay, how do we make use of that? If you think about what I've done over here, I've basically said, look, I'll use some three digits in order to represent the value, the actual sort of precision of the number, and I will use some additional digits, 0, 3, minus 15, etc., in order to represent what my exponent is supposed to be. Okay, I'm just going to separate those out. Okay, so what was proposed in order to do the same thing for binary was to say, let's say that I have a 32-bit range of values. Okay, let me divide this and say I'll have my exponent over here, and the remaining part, which is the actual value, I call it the mantis sum. Okay, and the choice, one choice that was made in this case was to basically say I will use 23 bits to store the mantis sum, 8 bits to store the exponent, and 1 bit for the sign. Okay, why am I suddenly breaking away from my 2's complement and having my sign separately in a, you know, this is something called the sign magnitude format, right? So in other words, the mantissa is always assumed to be a positive value, and the sign is explicitly represented, 0 is positive, 1 is negative, as a separate bit. You can do that even with integers, right? I could choose that out of my 8 bits, I'll always consider my MSB to be special, I'll treat it only as a sign bit. You'll probably realize that, you know, that limits you in one way, saying that I can only have plus minus 127. I lose that minus 128 representability. On the other hand, I have two representations for 0. I have plus 0 and minus 0. Okay. In the case of floating point, people decided it was worth it. Right? It's not like you can just add two floating point numbers together anyway. For doing anything, addition, subtraction, etc., you need to do some slightly more tricky things. So let's just use a separate sign bit to represent the value. Now what does this give us? Basically, what the interpretation of this 32-bit value is to say, I will take the mantissa part as my actual value, 3.14 or whatever it is, right? But I'm going to be a bit clever over here. Just like you would never see, you know, in all of these numbers, I would never normally write something like 0.45 into 10 power 6. What I would write is 4.50 into 10 power 5. Why? What's the difference? That mantissa having a 0 to the left of the integer is actually a waste, right? I can always accommodate that into my exponent, and by making sure that the mantissa, the part to the left of the left of the decimal point, is not a 0, it means that this 4.50, you may think that that 0 has no value, but over here it actually does. It is telling you that the answer is 4.50, not 4.5. Right? What's the difference? Because if I just say 4.5, in general the assumption is that it means 4.5 plus minus something in the LSB. But 4.50 is 4.50 plus minus half LSB. Okay, so 4.5 basically represents the range 4.45 to 4.55, right? 4.5 represents the range 4.45 to 4.55, but 4.50 represents the range 4.495 to 4.505. This is more precise. Okay, I would like to have that additional digit of accuracy, right? So even in decimal we do this, we call it normalized floating point or normalized scientific notation. So here what we say is the mantissa, I will assume, always has a 1 in front of it, followed by 23 bits of mantissa. Okay, so basically it becomes a 24 bit value into 2 to the power of, not 10 to the power of, but 2 to the power of this e that I have over here. Okay, but as one added twist, which is not easy to justify but makes sense when you actually go into the development of this notation, they just do e minus 127, where this is treated as a unsigned 8 bit integer. Okay, what is an unsigned 8 bit integer? It just means it has values in the range 0 up to 255, 0 up to 2 power 8 minus 1. So e is a number in the range 0 to 255. I take that, subtract 127. So in other words, e is not using 2's complement, e is just an unsigned integer. I am then going to subtract 127 in order to get the actual value that it has. That's not exactly the same as using 2's complement, right? Look at the numbers, you'll realize that it's actually something else called a base offset arithmetic. But it gives you the same range of values, right? You're not going to lose anything over there. What happens over here, this 1.mm, the maximum value, or rather the minimum value that I can have over here is 1.000 is equal to 1, and the max value is going to be equal to 1.111, which is 2 minus 2 power minus 23, which is approximately equal to 2. Okay, some 1.99 something. Okay. Now, what this means is I have got a 32 bit value similar to my 32 bit integers, but now I've got a 32 bit value. What am I going to do with it? I want to find out. I know that I can represent numbers using this format. Okay. An example number would be something like 0, 0, whatever, you know, and something of this sort, right? This would be exponent, this would be mantissa, and this is the sign. Okay, so this value is going to be equal to 1.10100 into 2 power 106 minus 127. Okay, or in other words, some whatever 1.5 something into 2 power minus 21, which is approximately equal to 1.5 into 10 power minus 7. Okay, so if I had a number like this, this is how I would interpret it. Okay, what impact does this have on the dynamic range? Now let's look at the dynamic range, right? The interesting thing to keep in mind is this mantissa now has nothing to do with the dynamic range. It has very little influence on the dynamic range because the mantissa at most has a dynamic range of 2. It can go from 1 up to 2. Okay, so it can't have a significant influence on the final dynamic range. But what it does is it allows you to give precision. 4.50, 4.501, 4.5013, right? Those kind of digits, the extra digits, can be represented in the mantissa. The exponent takes care of the dynamic range. How does it do it? Smallest positive value corresponds to sine equal to 0 because it's positive. Exponent equal to, I want the smallest value, therefore exponent equal to 1, right? I'm going to say 0 is reserved for another purpose, so I'm not going to allow 0. If I don't allow 0, the smallest exponent I can have is 1, okay, which basically corresponds to 2 power 1 minus 127 equal to 2 power minus 126. And this also corresponds to an m equal to 0, which means the actual value is 1.0 into 2 power minus 126. Okay. What's the largest positive value? Again, s is equal to 0, this is a sine bit. E in this case is again, it should be 255, but once again 255 is reserved. I'll say 254 is permitted. Which means that it basically corresponds to 2 power 254 minus 127 is equal to 2 power plus 127. Okay. And the mantissa in this case is all ones, which basically corresponds to a value of 1.999 something into 2 power plus 127. Okay. 2 power minus 126 is approximately equal to 10 power minus 40, somewhere around that. And this is approximately equal to, again, 2 power plus 128, once again somewhere around 10 power plus 40, 41, 42, something of that sort. I'm just going to write it as 40, it's close enough. Okay, what's my dynamic range? (coughs) 10 power 80. Okay, 32 bits of storage, right? I'm using, how much memory am I using in the computer? 32 bits. With those 32 bits, integers or fixed point numbers, the dynamic range that I could get was 10 power 9. The same 32 bits organized in a different way, interpreted in a different way, that's all. The computer doesn't know what the difference is. It's just storing 32 bits of data. It's up to you or the program you write in order to interpret it differently. You get a dynamic range of 10 power 80. Okay, just because you have allocated some space for the exponent, and each number can now carry its own scaling factor along with it. What do you lose? Have you lost anything here? Precision. I now have only 23 bits of mantissa. I had 32 bits earlier, right? 31 bits. That has been reduced. So essentially, whatever I lost, whatever I gained in the exponent, that many bits I have lost for the mantissa. It turns out that even for scientific computations, in most cases, the dynamic range improvement is better than the loss in the precision. Or more important, the dynamic range improvement is more important than the loss in precision. Okay. Having said that, what I have described so far is something called single precision floating point. Why floating point versus fixed point? In fixed point, you know, the name itself suggests the decimal point location has been fixed by convention. I just say 4.4 and that's it. You can't really move it anywhere. Whereas floating point, every number carries its own exponent with it. Okay. Single precision basically refers to the fact that this is 32 bits. Okay, and in fact, to be more precise, this is something called the IEEE 754 standard. Okay, it's like I told you, it's a convention. The IEEE, the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, they have defined this as a standard that everyone can follow. Okay, and once you follow this, it basically says, look, this is exactly the meaning of standard IEEE single precision floating point. Okay, obviously what that means is you could have different kinds of precision. You can improve upon this, you can increase the number of bits, you can decrease the number of bits. Okay, what happens when you do things of that sort, plus what are the implications in terms of hardware and implementation of all of this, we will look at in the next class. Okay, so I'll stop here for now. This is basically the definition, how IEEE standard single precision floating point is defined. Similarly, you can define double precision, half precision, something else called a float 16, right? Many variants are there that have different properties that make them more useful or less useful in different contexts. We'll get into that in a little bit more detail in the next time before moving on to other properties of signal processing.